Ladies and gentlemen, this is Barely Legal from the White Panda. My name is Lawrence, and I'll be your host, accompanied by my assistant, Elizabeth.
Hello, Panda fans. I am so excited to be a part of this album.
Please, bitch, don't kill my vibe.
All of my face, both feel stay up on my waist. Bless it, ain't know me for enough. So please don't make me catch a case. Cause somebody, me walk around with no check on me. Psh, yeah, I doubt it. Your girl ain't finna leave with me. Psh, yeah, I doubt it. And I'm like, what the hell are they talking about? And if I got it, I bought it. Cause boy, you know I'm cashing out.
Alrighty, guys. Well, welcome back to GoRGN TV. Now we have Gooseman in the building. The Counter-Strike god to a lot of us here. He's going to be joining us for a little bit of Q&A. And it's going to be a very interesting interview here as we're going to pick his brain a little bit about Counter-Strike, the history, and everything that goes along with that. So, welcome, Gooseman. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, yeah, thanks for having me. It's my pleasure. Glad I can make it.
All right, well, who would like to start off? NaPPy, Shen?
I didn't get that question. Can you repeat that?
It wasn't a question. It was kind of just segueing into us saying words at you. Yeah, so we kind of mentioned, as people may not have known, and I asked earlier, if you were still in Korea. Because you had moved. Go ahead.
Yeah. No. I left Korea in January. I was working there for about 5 years, I guess. So I was kind of living in Korea for like the better part of 5 years. And just recently, I guess back in January, the company just kind of didn't really have enough money to like pay for a lot of people's salaries. So I just decided to part ways with them and basically just left.
And where did you land up after you left Korea? Sorry.
I just back home to Canada. I'm from Vancouver, Canada. So I have some family back here, and I moved back here, staying with my parents. Embarrassingly enough, right now I'm doing work over the internet for other companies for other game projects. So yeah.
Yeah, that's exciting. Is there any game you can mention that you're working on?
I'm working on a game called Rust. It's this open world survival.
A game called Rust.
Yeah.
I'm gonna light the chat up right there. Everybody knows about Rust here.
Yeah. Okay. Well, Rust is really popular, and I'm just working with Gary Newman and his company, and like I'm really enjoying it because those guys are really really just easy to work with, and they got a lot of talent there, and just I just really enjoy the environment because Gary's a really he's a really laid back guy, you know. He's my boss, but you know he's very very just easy to work with, you know. He's not strict or anything. So
Face Punch Studios, huh?
Yeah, yeah. They make Gary's mod, obviously.
Are you just contracting or actually?
Yeah, I'm just doing contract work for the moment. So yeah, I mean, as long as they like me, they'll keep me on. I take it.
Of course,
so,
yeah.
Are you gonna make it so we can bunny hop in Rust?
He doesn't like bunny hopping, dude.
Oh no!
No, actually, I don't really have much. I don't really have much say in the game design. Like, I'm mostly just doing animations and some helping out with some modeling and whatnot. But mostly just helping out with their animations of the weapons and also some of the animals and player animations. So yeah, I don't really have much input into the design of the game.
Got you. Well, it's still, I just purchased it yesterday and played it for about 15 minutes, and I was having a lot of fun, so I'm looking forward to seeing those Gooseman influences in the game as well, so that'll be fun.
Yeah. We're actually vamping the entire game, so I think the version on Steam right now, it's going to get overhauled quite dramatically, because we're like, redoing a lot of the graphics, and just, like, doing a lot of overhauls on the game, so it's gonna look much better in the coming months. So, because the game as it is right now, it's kind of hacked together. It has
Oops.
A lot of yeah, yeah. But anyways, yeah, it's promising. It's working on a project that has such promise in it, and yeah, I'm really excited in the coming months because I think the game's gonna really look great.
Outside of Counter-Strike, yeah, I feel like Rust is probably the only game in the past 3 or 4 years that I've got truly addicted to. For like 2 weeks, I just couldn't stop playing. So it's interesting that Gooseman's working on one of the only other games I've got addicted to.
Yeah, well, I was lucky to fall into Rust. I mean, actually, one of the guys that was working on the main programmer of Rust... His name's Helk, and he actually used to work with me on TI. So when we were working on TI, we grew closer, and he kind of recommended me onto Rust because they needed an animator. So yeah, that's kind of how I fell into Rust.
Very cool. Do you want more influence in that game, or is it not yours? You don't want to even get involved? Do you like being a...
Yeah, you know, I'm kind of like... You know, I mean, to be honest, they do so many great things with it that I don't really feel that there's much that I can really provide in terms of, like, the design of the game. Like, I mean, it's already done so well as it is. So, I mean, like, I don't really have much input to really give to it. But, I mean, like, Gary's a really cool guy, though. I mean, like, if I have something to say, and, like, he'll totally listen to it. But, I mean, I think I'm not very, I don't really have much to say about how to make Rust better. So, because I'm just really just focused on making the animations and that sort of thing. And to be honest, like, gotcha. after working on TI for so long, I'm kind of exhausted from game design. It's very kind of it's draining, you know, mentally. It's mentally draining for me. So, you know,
probably emotionally too. I mean, that's
that's
your baby.
That's a good point. That's a very, very good point, because I spent like 8 years on that stupid game, and you know, a lot of it was just mismanaged, and just, you know, I don't want to point fingers or anything, but you know, I mean, I made my own mistakes, but at the same time, I think working with that company in Korea was probably the worst thing I've ever. That was the worst decision I ever made. So you know, I mean, that's pretty much all I'll say about those guys. But yeah, I mean, I'm really glad to be gone from that company because it was a nightmare for me, and yeah.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
I have a question. Are you proud of TI outside of the management issues and sort of with the game? If we just look at the pure game, are you satisfied with that?
Satisfied with TI?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, like, I think a bit of yes, a bit of no. I mean, there's certain aspects of it that I was really proud of. Like, for example, the vehicle mode, that's something that turned out really well. Also, like, some of the elements that we added that I felt turned out quite well, I was really happy with, was, like, the dogs. That turned out well, in my opinion. But I think the thing that really frustrated me was just the fact that we were tied down to the free-to-play mechanism. Like, because it was a free-to-play game, we had to make a lot of, like, decisions that affected gameplay. Like, for example, we couldn't... like, there was no progression of the guns. You know, in CS, you start off with a pistol, and then you progress to a better power gun. With free-to-play games, you don't have that progression, and that really affected the game in kind of... I mean, a lot of CS players were kind of, like, confused with it at first, and it was kind of... It was hard for us to balance the game, because, you know, you never knew how powerful the players were going to be. Like, you might have a team full of, like really really powerful guns, and because of that, it was just very difficult for us to design a lot of the game mechanics. So
sure.
So yeah, that was kind of frustrating for me. I mean, in terms of like the overall product, like the actual game of TI, yeah, I mean, I think I was proud of what we were able to achieve with such a small team, because a lot of people don't realize how small it was. I mean for the most. I think we were working on it for 8 years, but I think the majority of that time we only had a team of 3 people. And then near the end, we got like 5 people. And it was like, this is ridiculous. We can't make a game with 5 people. So, I mean, it just became more than we bargained for, you know, because when I first envisioned of going to that company in Korea, they I was under the impression that we were going to have a larger team of like 20 or 30 people. But over the course of time, I mean, the management, they couldn't recruit more people for various reasons I can't really get into. But basically, we were just stuck with working with like 3 people. And that was a big reason why the game just looked so unfinished. You know, it doesn't look really polished. It doesn't look really nice. And there's a lot of corners that we cut because of the fact that we just had like a small team of three or four people. So yeah.
I share your distaste for free to play, because it free to play is, to me, always seems like a slightly misleading term. You know, it should be more of a pay to win than anything.
Yeah, I have a lot of friends that work on free to play games, and I and it's hard for me to bash free to play as a system of publishing your game. But you know, I come from an old school where I liked it when games were just kind of sold as like individual units. You pay your money for it and you get the whole game. By having a free to play mechanism, it really as a game developer, it just really makes my job harder to just design the game around the whole mechanism of, okay, is everybody going to be buying certain things or that kind of thing. So it really just frustrates me as a game developer. But at the same time, I look at the industry the way it is right now. There's just so many game developers out there, and there's not enough game consumers. There's not enough people like putting money into the game industry. So what you have is you have these people that are kind of like these game developers that are trying to make a living. So they won't be able to survive if they put a price tag on their game. So they have to resort to this free to play mechanism, because you know, I mean, free games are kind of like people will just download and check that out. You know, there's no entrance fee, but. But yeah, I mean, it has its pros and cons, and you know, I really miss the old days of 10 years ago when we just made a game, we sold it for like whatever amount of money, and then so it just kept things simple. But yeah, I mean, it's a totally changed industry.
I think you and the rest of the chat actually wants to rewind the clock about 10 years and go back to gaming the way that it was back then.
Yeah, but I really think that it's really just a byproduct of just the saturation of game developers in this industry. There's just far too many of us. You know, there's just way. I mean, you look on Steam, like every freaking week or every 2 weeks, there's 100 games on Greenlight. You know, and you know, I'm not kind of bashing the quality. There's tons of great games out there, but unfortunately, just the sheer volume of games makes it very difficult for the game industry to just really survive with this many developers, you know, without, yeah. You know. So it's a challenge. It's a real challenge for indie developers.
I think it's a specific challenge to your genre and the fact that your game doesn't have a beginning or end. You're looking for people to play this consistently for as long as they want.
Yes. I totally agree with that as well. Being a multiplayer game, you're really kind of trying to... pull from the same player base as other multiplayer games like Call of Duty, like CS:GO, and these games are so well established. They're so like they're so strong player base that it's a huge challenge to pull players from that community. So you know, like you, exactly what you said. It, our game is not a single player game. You know, where players can just oh, you know, I'll check it out. I'll pay $10 to check this out. You know, they'll play it for like a couple hours and they'll be satisfied, and that's that. Being a multiplayer game, we actually have to like convince players to stop playing the other multiplayer game because we're fighting for their time, and that's a real challenge.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I want to see if you would modify your statement. It sounds like you're saying it's very difficult to be a game creator at this time, but I think that it's probably the easiest time to be a single player, easily consumed game creator than it ever has been.
Yeah, I think there's some truth to that. I mean, I think like in general, it's a bit easier to sell a single player game because I think in general, most people would prefer to play those games like they don't really hesitate as much to pay $10 for a single player game versus paying $10 for a multiplayer game, because like to pay $10 for a multiplayer game, you have to convince the consumer that okay, you're going to be playing this game for like hours and hours and you're never going to play your other multiplayer games, whereas people understand that it's just a single experience, kind of like watching a movie, so they're more to really pay a single price tag on that one. So yeah, I think like you never see any free to play single player games. I guess that's what
no.
I'm saying. Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. And I don't think it's possible. I don't think you will see a free to play single player game. I think that just really doesn't work that well.
No, I don't think it's possible. Yeah.
Yeah, but so that's the challenge for us people who develop multiplayer games. We're kind of fighting for the same player base.
Right.
It's very limited, you know.
Yeah, I think you have to be new or you're not going to make it. You can't compete with FPS, at least realistic FPS tactical shooters, unless you have some groundbreaking game mechanic.
Yeah.
That's executed flawlessly. And or you have something completely new, like Rust, like Minecraft isn't an FPS, I guess. Rust or DayZ and the other.
Yeah, exactly. I think those two games, I wouldn't even classify them as FPSs. They're more, they kind of cater more towards the survivalist crowd. Because, you know, a lot of players on Rust, they can't shoot for shit, man. I mean, they're not even shooters. They're like, they're just people who like to just gang up on others. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, Rust is a great game because it appeals to people who aren't regular FPS players, and I think that's why Rust has been able to succeed so well, that they're not fighting for the same people who play CS:GO, they're fighting for like a different crowd, so it's a bit easier for them to succeed versus someone who decided to make a FPS multiplayer game.
I will say firsthand that there is a huge overlap there. For Rust specifically and DayZ between FPS players. I'd say I have like 150 or some odd players on my friends list, and I would estimate that 70% of them own Rust.
Okay. So I guess there is a huge overlap of FPS players.
Yeah, no, I mean, and that's a small sample. I'm not saying that I'm the end all, but I do feel like there is a huge overlap.
Okay, well that's a good point to make, and I think that's something that I guess I didn't realize, but at the same time I think a lot of non FPS players are gonna pick up Rust as well.
Sure.
So I guess if you were to if I were to make an estimation, like I would say like maybe 40% of the players who play Rust don't play FPS games. You know, I guess. That might be a safe assumption. Yeah,
I would imagine
serpentining and dodging bullets a whole lot easier. Because none of them can aim. But to try to get back towards like the Counter-Strike side of things, I know we've talked about Rust a whole handful so far, but you know, have you obviously your development on 1.6 and everything like that, notwithstanding, have you had a chance to play any of the newer versions of Counter-Strike, either Source or when ProMod was making its up and coming, or have you tried out Global Offensive at all?
So you're asking me if I played CS:GO and some of the later versions of CS?
Yeah.
Actually, I stopped playing CS at about CS 1.0. Yeah, it was a long time ago.
That's a while ago.
Oh, honesty, that, honesty. Yeah,
I mean, I played a bit of CS Source, and I played a bit of CS:GO, but it was nothing like that substantial. I mean, I think in total, I must have spent like 20 hours on CS Source, and then, you know, maybe 20 hours on CS:GO. Yeah, it just, I guess I just became so busy as a developer that back when I was playing a lot of CS, I just had a lot more free time, I guess you can say, yeah. So, I don't know, these days I'm just like so busy making games that it's just hard for me to find time to play them as well. And plus, at the same time, I'll be honest with you, I'm a bit bored with CS kind of gameplay, because I don't know, maybe it's just because I didn't play it competitively, but I usually just played it like public servers, and I guess I didn't really have as much friends who played it, so... Yeah, I mean, most of the people that I used to play CS with, I mean, they stopped playing CS. They played Call of Duty and that kind of thing. So,
most people do, yeah.
Yeah, you know, they kind of. I don't know why, because I mean, they're like the same age as me. They're like 37, but they play like these games that are much more casual. And I guess that's the reason, because they're much quicker to play. You don't need to invest as much time into them. You know, I mean, they're kind of quick pick 'em up games, kind of. Yeah,
easier to learn. The learning curve isn't as severe, and the enjoyment factor is.
I just
want to
point out that you heard it from Gooseman himself. Call of Duty is casual.
Saying. Yeah. Well, you know, I'll be honest with you. I played a lot of Call of Duty Modern Warfare. Which one was it? The Modern Warfare 1. So it was Call of Duty 4. The first Modern Warfare, I played the hell out of that. I really loved that one. That was great. It was solid. Like, the satisfaction of shooting the guys was great, you know. And for me, that was what it was all about. Just the gun mechanics and just the satisfaction of, like, shooting your enemy. That was really well done in Call of Duty, the first Modern Warfare. And the maps were just awesome as well. So I think that was the biggest reason why I loved that game. Just really great map design and just, yeah.
It's funny, there's a comment in the chat right now that said, you made CS but hasn't played it since the launch. And somebody responded by saying, why would he? He won the internet.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, after you play CS for, like, 8 years, and, you know, to be honest, it hasn't changed that much. The gameplay hasn't changed. I mean, it's all about just pure reflexes, and it's a very, very pure game. It doesn't have a lot of extra, you know, stupid stuff like the kill streaks. So it's really purely based on player skill. So I think that's why it's been able to survive for so long, you know?
Well, as we're sitting here talking, I'm sitting here in the stream looking at the chat, and I couldn't help but noticing on the graphics, one of your quotes, it says, when I was at Valve, I was self-conscious about my leadership abilities. Everyone at Valve, they're like geniuses. Now, looking back, I mean, you're the creator of Counter-Strike. You know, has your attitude changed at all?
Yeah, you know, I think I was just really young at the time, so I was I guess I was like 23, so I was at the age where I wasn't really sure of my abilities. You know, I honestly, back then I thought CS was just lucky. I just got lucky with CS because, you know, it just kind of came out at the right time, and if you look at it, CS, even to this day, it's not a very complicated game. It's a pretty simple game. All it is like you buy guns and then you go shoot each other, and, you know, a lot of it has to do with the level design and the maps. And I wasn't really involved in any of that, so I couldn't really take much of the credit for, like, the success of CS. And to me, CS seems like such a simple game that it didn't really. Like, it didn't really show that I was a great game designer. I was just kind of like some guy that just put a few guns together and just, you know, had a system where you buy the guns and that was it. You know, to me, I never really, to summarize, I basically didn't really feel CS was that great of a game. You know, I just thought that it just came out at the right time. I think that was the thing. The timing was just perfect. You know, it was just, and at the time there was no other game like it. So, you know, I guess that's what really helped it to blow up, and I guess that was it, you know.
Yeah, we haven't seen anything up until that time that was that kind of a team-based game. Where,
we had Urban Terror.
Yeah, oh, yeah. It really laid the framework for FPSs.
Exactly, and that's what made it stand the test of time, and it's amazing the replay value of a game as simple as buy guns and kill each other.
Yeah, and I think that's the biggest thing for CS's success. It was heavily team play focused, and it was heavily reliant on player skill as opposed to, like, luck, like, or just, you know, because I think at the time there's other games like Quake and Unreal Tournament which which were really high skilled games, but I think they were far less teamwork or focused, and I think players were kind of sick of the whole science fiction thing. So
yeah, maybe, they're very arcadey. Yeah.
Now, an interesting statement was made in our chat by Equal87. He said, has anybody asked you about everybody calling a spot by your name on one of the maps in Counter-Strike? On Dust 2, there is Goose. We all call Goose because it's got your name stenciled there on the side of the wall for 1.6. How do you feel about that? It's become notorious over the years.
It's crazy. It's I'm really honored by that, to be honest. The guy that made Dust is a really good friend of mine. His name's David Johnson. He's like a super great time working with him, and so I guess we got along really well. And I didn't even know that he put my name on the map, so you know, I was really honored that he actually did that. So
and that it's was the just, most played map in Counter-Strike history too.
Yeah, exactly. So it was a really interesting thing because, you know, I didn't actually know about it until someone told me. Like, I was like, what are you talking about? My name's on the maps? What are you talking about? So he was like, yeah, someone put a spray paint of your name. So, yeah, it was great. It was really, really a big honor for me. And, David Johnson is just a great guy. He's out in Britain, and he works for a company called forgot the name of it, but they made a game called Quake Wars Enemy Territory. I don't know if you're familiar with that game.
I've played that briefly.
Yeah, he also made another game called Brink. It's like a FPS game as well. So, Splash Damage. Yeah, that's the name of the company. Splash Damage. Yeah.
You know, I think so, Brink came out, what, 2 or 3 years ago now? I don't know. I can't remember. But it did
Brink,
have...
Brink, it came out like 4 years ago, I think, or three or something. Yeah.
Yeah, not too long ago, at least in the scope of what we're talking, Counter-Strike.
No, it was like, I think 3 years. And it looked kind of like TF2. It had kind of like a weird sci-fi kind of feel to it, yeah.
So I got messaged a question here that I think is actually a pretty interesting question. Buddy of mine said, what made you decide to go from... like Navy SEALs as a Quake mod into CS as a Half-Life mod?
Actually, it was more of just the evolution of the game engines. Like, I actually worked on a Doom mod, and then I worked on a Quake mod, and then I worked on a Quake 2 mod called Action Quake 2. So, and then when Half-Life came out, I worked on that. So it was just sort of the progression of games that got released. Like, at the time, I tended to work on the latest engines. So it didn't make sense for me to work on an older Quake engine. So when Half-Life came out, I was just like, yeah, this looks like the next big thing, and it had a lot of great features that the Quake engine didn't have. So I didn't hesitate to make a mod for that one. And yeah.
Speaking of Half-Life, you know, trying to get a little bit of the inside scoop here. Do you by any chance know anything about Half-Life 3?
Half-Life 3?
Did you... that's a good question. Can we get a confirmation on Half-Life 3?
You know, I mean,
Gaben's en route.
Yeah, you know, like there's like a laser sight in my head right now. Yeah. You know? I don't know if I can talk about that, to be honest, but I mean, I think it's kind of public knowledge that people know that it is being worked on, and so if I were to say that, I've seen some images, like some concept art of it. You know, that wouldn't be big news, to be honest. But yeah, I mean, like, I guess I could say that I did see something that looked kind of like in the Half-Life universe. And you know, I mean, like, it wouldn't surprise anyone if I said, yeah, they're working on it. So yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, to go on a limb, I would say, yeah, I did see some concept art for Half-Life 3. Yeah.
Sweet. Half-Life 3 confirmed.
Awesome.
Yeah, okay, somebody's knocking on my door right now. hopefully that doesn't get out. But yeah, it seems like old news by now anyways. I think everyone kind of knows it's being worked on. But,
absolutely.
But, you know, the one thing I'm really excited about is Left 4 Dead, the new Left 4 Dead.
Really?
Yeah.
I want to talk a little bit about that? Because I know about Left 4 Dead 1 and 2. I played them both pretty heavily for a while, but they're working on a third, I assume?
Well, they've already said they are.
They said. So, I mean, it wouldn't be any news if I said that, yes, I saw it, and it looks great. Yeah. So I was really excited when I saw that. I was like, wow, this looks great, you know. Because I really enjoyed Left 4 Dead, and it was just one of those games that, you know, just really changed the industry. Because I think at the time, there wasn't many good co-op games. So it was like, yeah, this is a great co-op game, you know.
By the way, that Navy SEALs Quake mod question that I asked you was from Daybreak. He said that he knows you. So.
Oh, yeah, Daybreak. Yes, it rings a bell. Yes, I think he's on my Steam friends list. Yeah. Hey, Daybreak. Yeah. Shout out to him. Yeah. It's always cool seeing those guys.
Gotcha.
So how many hours have you put into CSGO, you think?
Not too much. Because at the time I was working on TI, and I was super busy. I was working like freaking like 12, 13 hours a day. So I didn't have much time to even play any other games. So
right.
So I probably only put like 10. I probably played like 20 hours of CSGO.
Oh, that's enough to at least like have experienced it, see the Molotovs. And...
Yeah. So I mean, like I was kind of surprised when I saw the Molotovs because we had that in TI, and I was like, we're like, damn it. Beat us to the punch. Yeah, so I was like,
Is there anything in CS? Oh, sorry. Go ahead. Continue.
Yeah, and then I noticed that they have a full automatic pistol called, you know, it's one of the new pistols in CS:GO, and I was like, damn, we got that in TI. So I don't know. I'm just ribbing them, but I'm pretty sure they're not copying TI. But it's not worth copying. To be
honest.
I
mean, it would make sense that they go back to the well. Yeah.
I guess making a fully automatic pistol isn't much of a like isn't really that innovative anyway, so yeah.
I know, but a lot of CSGO players that despise that, myself being one of them. I hate getting killed by that automatic pistol.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah. It just, it seems so cheap, man. It's $300 in the game, and you can just hold an angle with it and spray down, like, four people.
Damn! Is it that powerful? Shit, I didn't
it's
realize.
It's pretty strong. Yeah. It's pretty strong.
Huh, that's crazy. Yeah, the one in TI is probably not as strong as that, but it's kind of like the Glock 18. Yeah.
Gotcha. Oh, see, that the Glock is pretty powerful in CSGO, too.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Yeah. But, yeah, it's... So, I don't know, the guys that I work with on TI, they're kind of like, oh, when are they going to add a dog to CSGO? So, we were just joking about that, but... I don't think they will.
Spawn an attack dog down long A of Dust 2.
Doesn't Call of Duty Ghost have dogs now?
Yeah, they do. So we were kind of like, oh god, they beat us to the punch as well. So, anyways, I don't think it's that much of a feature anyways. But I had a lot of fun with the dogs in TI though. I mean, they kind of added something for me. So.
Well, was there anything while you were playing the new Counter-Strike that you were like, what were they thinking?
Oh my... I was really just impressed with the whole package, just the polish of the everything. It just
yeah.
I mean, it just looked so.
Should have played the beta, man.
Oh, was it really flaky? Yeah.
There were some things that were.
Yeah.
Rough, yeah.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, I did actually play one of the earlier versions before it was even released. When I was I visited Valve at one time, and they had me play test CSGO for a bit, and I was kind of like, oh, okay, cool. And yeah, it changed quite a bit from then, though, because that was like 4 years ago, I think, or 3 years. So.
Yeah, we're still getting regular patches of them, updating certain things, fixing some stuff. They do listen to the community pretty well on a lot of the things that they're modifying, so...
Yeah, you know, that's what Valve is really good at.
Catering.
They really, really respect the community, because, you know, after all, that's really where their money comes from, so it's something that they really, really just focus on.
What do you think about the whole skins thing in CSGO?
It's not my particular, like, I don't particularly care much about it, but I can sort of see why people like it, because it's making a huge, like, I mean, there's a lot of players that play CSGO just to collect skins. Like, they don't even play the game. Like, they just collect skins. Like, they're not even FPS players. So, right. I think by doing that, I think it just really improves the popularity of the game. But I mean, me personally, I'm not a skins guy. I don't really care that much. I'm not really kind of like I don't really. I'm not like, to be honest. I don't even wear nice clothes. I just wear like potato sacks and shit. You know, obviously, I really dress up with shit. I'm not like vain or anything. I don't drive a nice car. I don't really. You know, I'm kind of like, I'm just very, very like, I don't care. I just wear anything. You know, I just do whatever. You know, so when I see people like playing the game and getting these nice skins, I don't see the appeal. But personally, but I kind of sort of see. I can understand why there's so many people out there like that, because you know, I just go outside. I see a bunch of people like souping up their cars, and you know that's kind of the crowd that these skins kind of cater to. So,
Gotcha. People we actually shit, have yeah. a really good question in the chat. Smiles TV asks, if Half-Life 3 does come out, would you ever consider working on a new version of Counter-Strike with the new game engine?
Yeah. I actually, you know, I'll be honest. I actually considered it. Because I saw the new engine, and, like, it's really nice, and...
Hold on. You've seen the new Source 2 engine?
I'm not sure if I should talk about that. Well, I mean, like, wait a minute, but you guys already know that it's been announced.
Right, you know,
I mean,
they've announced that, yeah.
Okay, yeah, you know what? I can say that I've seen it. You know, I mean, it's not, I don't think anyone's going to be too upset if I, yeah, I mean, I have seen it. It's really impressive. And, you know, because I really enjoyed working on Source, I think I liked Source so much because it was so flexible. It was such a versatile engine. Like, if you wanted to change anything about it, you can do that. There was no limitations on it. So, but then again, I'm looking at new engines like Unity and Unreal Engine, and they're kind of like doing a lot of stuff that, like, to be honest, the new Source engine does as well. So I mean, it's really kind of, there's no I guess there's no I wouldn't be surprised if I made a game on the Unreal Engine versus the new Source engine. So there's nothing really convincing me either way, kind of, you know. So,
well, have you looked at the just the community Steam, fact that you're running off of Steam with the new Source engine, and how you can implement that to build communities?
That's because I guess, yeah, the engine will have such a close relationship with Steam, and the back-end system will be so closely supported that it is attractive to work on the new Source engine because of that. But at the same time, I think the Unreal Engine, the new Unreal Engine, does a good job of being very Steam-friendly and having a lot of good integration with Steam as well.
I think you have to be at this point.
Exactly. I think so as well, because if you want to succeed in this in the PC industry, you and your engine,
then
has
you
to
play
be
nice
really...
with Steam.
Exactly. I totally agree with that. You know, I mean, because you nobody competes with Steam. Yeah. So. Yeah.
They are the monopoly when it comes to the video game corner of the universe right now.
PC gaming, yeah. And if you're playing anything that isn't Blizzard owned or EA owned, yep.
Yeah, I know. I kind of feel bad. I kind of feel sorry when I look at EA and their Origin thing, but, you know.
I don't feel sorry for them. They milk their customers. They put out a new game for, like, every single franchise every year. I don't feel bad.
Yeah. I guess I don't feel as bad because of that. But I guess what I'm trying to say is the fact that, you know, at one point, EA was actually trying to compete with Steam. They were trying to attract a lot of developers to publish their games on Origin, but... because I have a lot of friends that were, like, approached by EA and were saying, hey, please consider putting your game on Source or on the Origin thing, and they were like, no, there's no player base there and that kind of thing. Well, only EA players play there, so they have a huge challenge in that regard, trying to compete with Steam. I mean, sure, they have their own games, but I don't really think that you'll ever see another game that's not made by EA on the Origin thing. You know, I'd be surprised, maybe, I don't know, but then again, yeah. But, I mean, you know, because I think most of the people that have Origin, they already have Steam as well, so there's no, why would you want to buy from Origin versus Steam? Yeah, so, yeah. You'd have to be a complete retard to have, like, Origin and not have Steam, you know, it's weird.
Or just, like, a, I don't know, some sort of different nerd.
Yeah, or like
a different kind of nerd.
EA fanboy or something.
Yeah, like playing The Sims or something. I don't even know what's on Origin. But.
Yeah, well, you know, they have Titanfall, so that's their biggest, that's their huge thing. They have Titanfall, so...
That's not Counter-Strike.
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess, yeah, for those people who prefer CS, but... I heard it's a good game. I heard it's a really good game.
I heard one of your interviews where you said that you played Hawken.
I did. I do play Hawken. I used to play it a lot. I stopped playing it about a year ago because I just got too busy. But then I played it recently on Steam, and it changed so much that I kind of like, I don't really like it as much as I did a year ago. Because a year ago, Hawken was a different game in that you can take a lot more damage. Like, you had a higher health, but now it's like they kind of cut the health down by 50%. So you die much quicker. So I was like, I didn't really enjoy that as much. I kind of preferred having the higher health because it gave me a chance to work with my teammates a bit better. So now it's just kind of like I don't have as much time to react. So I didn't really enjoy the change.
Yeah.
But yeah, you guys play Hawken? Any of you guys?
No, actually, the first exposure I had to it was my brother, maybe 3 weeks ago. He found it and started playing it. Mm-hmm. And I was like, what in the world? I didn't download it because it's not for me. But
would you recommend it?
I would, I think.
A year ago?
Yeah, maybe. No. I mean, it's still a good game as it is now. You know, I mean, I really enjoy the graphic style because I come from a... I grew up heavily influenced by a lot of Japanese anime. Like I used to watch a lot of Japanese cartoons and that kind of thing. So for me, I could relate to the Hawken graphical style. I really appreciated it, and I really was really impressed with what they did with it. And so I think it really appealed to players like me, or just people like who grew up like kind of like with watching a lot of Japanese cartoons. But I guess for people who don't, because I have a lot of friends who don't play a lot of. I try to introduce them to Hawken, and they're like, well, what is this? It looks kind of weird. You know, because they don't really have much of a fascination with robot games. So I think that was kind of the challenge for Hawken to really appeal to people who didn't really like robot, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like Titanfall before Titanfall, sort of.
Can't get out of your mech in Hawken, I don't think.
Yeah, I mean, Hawken's quite a bit different than Titanfall. I guess, but I guess it does share a few similarities in that they both have robots, but Hawken is exclusively robots, so, I mean, yeah, but Titanfall is quite an interesting beast, so, I mean, I haven't played it myself, but I heard it's great.
From their advertisements?
Well, no, I have a few guys that play, I have quite a few people that I know that do play it a lot, and, yeah, I wouldn't be surprised because the same people that made Titanfall made the Call of Duty Modern Warfare 1. So those guys are really talented. You know, I have a lot of respect for them as developers.
Yeah, no, definitely. So I think you've said that you're not really... Well, I guess you're working on Rust. There's nothing coming out of Gooseman's mind for us to play in the near future. Listened to an interview recently where you mentioned mobile games. It made me sad on the inside, but
yeah. Well, you know, the thing is, I gave it a bit of thought, and the reason I like mobile games is because you can make them so fast. You know, I mean, like you can make them a lot faster than you can make a PC game. So the reason I was kind of attracted towards mobile games is because I'm kind of at the stage where I'm financially kind of. Well, to be honest, I'm broke, so I need money. So I don't want.
You came to the right place. We love you, Gooseman.
Yeah, well, you know, I don't really want to rely on people to like give me donations and that kind of thing.
Yeah,
I
don't
really
want to rest on a game you made 10 years ago. Yeah, I respect
exactly,
that.
Exactly, and I think that just looks kind of lame, to be honest. I've seen that before.
It does.
You know, and if it doesn't turn out, it just makes me look really lame and just pathetic. So I don't want to rely on that. But you know, I like mobile games because you know, if I have a chance to make a quick game and just you know make some money out of that, that to me is kind of an attractive thing because. I wouldn't want to spend the rest of my life making mobile games. So no, not at all. Because mobile
Stepping
games are
down.
So restrictive. Yeah, well, just a way for me to just take a break from PC and just some money, hopefully, you know. But who knows? Maybe I won't really consider it. Maybe I'll just keep working on Rust and just you know work from there. But yeah, I mean, like mobile games are kind of like they're kind of so restrictive in that you can't really have any complicated mobile games on it. So in that sense, I don't really envision myself working on mobile games exclusively. Just
right.
Just something as an experiment I would like to try making.
So if somebody came to you with an idea. And they were like, work with me on this. Are you interested? Mm-hmm. Or?
Well, no, I wouldn't want to work on someone else's mobile game. I think
well,
I would
no,
just
not a mobile
yeah.
game. I didn't mean a mobile game.
Oh, like somebody else's like PC game.
Right.
Well, yeah. Actually, like, well, that's kind of what happened with Rust. They were kind of like, they approached me, and like I really liked the guys working on it. Like, I have a lot of respect for Gary, and you know. And so, yeah, I was kind of like, yeah, you know, I didn't really have to consider it that much. I was just like, yeah. Plus, I needed the money, so, yeah.
Well, we all do. Yeah. You gotta find what earns the money.
Yeah, I know. I mean, at the end of the day, you gotta pay the bills, you know? I mean, like,
don't
that's
you wish you could be a
thing.
Professional Counter-Strike player? I mean...
Yeah. You know, it's cool because I met one of the biggest Counter-Strike players. His name is Fnatic. I don't know if you guys know
Karn.
Him.
You met Karn, and he is a badass. No, Fnatic's an organization.
Oh, no, the guy, the head of Fnatic, he's like this, he's a Swedish guy. Mm-hmm. I forgot, let me just get his name.
Is it Patrick Sattermark?
Yes, that
that's
guy.
That's Karn, yeah.
Oh, his name
He
Karn?
Was a professional, yeah, he was a professional
yes,
in-game
and,
leader.
And he retired, now he's mm-hmm. like managing guys, but I met him...
Preaching to the choir, man.
I met him in Germany, and he's a super nice guy, really, really nice guy, and yeah, it was kind of a... I didn't realize how big he was, but apparently he was one of the... biggest CS players ever, and so it
I
was
could tell you
honor.
All about it. Yeah.
Wow, really? So yeah. That's crazy. Yeah. So, but anyways, I was super nice. I was super excited to meet him because he was such a nice guy. And you know, sometimes you know, I kind of feel a bit like, wow, you know, all these guys are making money off CS. I wish I was like them. But when I meet a nice guy like Fnatic, I'm kind of like, I'm happy that people like him are able to make money off that of something I made. So I'm just really glad to know that it's really helped a lot of people.
Yeah, I have one last question for you that I was actually put in chat way at the beginning of the interview. They asked how did you segue from creating a game like CS into making a more survival feeling game like Rust?
Sorry, can you repeat that? You were breaking up a bit.
Oh, okay. It said, how did you segue from creating a game like Counter-Strike into a more survival-feeling type game like Rust?
Oh, yeah, it's quite a bit of a change. Like a lot of the things that they're doing is far different than what I'm accustomed to with CS. But the fact that I'm just really focusing on the animation and some of the artwork, in that it doesn't really, it's not a huge challenge, to be honest, because like making animations is the same as I do in Rust, as I made them in Counter-Strike or in TI. It's really the same process. But if I were to, like, if they asked me to do some like design, game design for Rust, you know, that's probably where I would probably have a bit of a challenge to it, because, like, as I say, I don't really play a lot of survivalist games. I didn't play DayZ, or I didn't play any of those other games, so I don't have a lot of experience, and I don't think I would have much to offer in terms of input. So, but okay. Yeah, for now, it's pretty for me, it's pretty easy because they just asked me to do artwork, and it's pretty much the same as I did with my previous games.
I was under the impression that you were a programmer, and I don't know if we're wrapping up here soon or you need to get on the road, I know.
Yeah, I'm a programmer as well. I do a lot of programming. I program a lot of TI, and I programmed all of CS. So, but they have so many good programmers working on Rust that they don't really need programmers as much as they need animators. So
sure.
that's kind of what they asked me to do. So, but yeah, if they ask me to do some programming, I'm pretty sure I can handle that, you know. But my programming is kind of messy, so I mean, I think most people don't really enjoy reading my code, so it's just, you know, it's kind of like, yeah.
Gotcha.
All right, well, I think that's going to pretty much wrap it up for us this evening. We definitely want to extend our thanks to you for joining us. We know that you've got to get on the road and help your girlfriend with her
problems. Oh, yeah, yeah, that's
problems,
right. She's,
so.
She's waiting for me.
Yeah,
right.
So yeah, we're gonna let you hit the road. Is there anything that you'd like to say to the people that are watching right now in your closing statements here?
Yeah, I just want to say thank you to everybody for like just supporting the game, and you know, I'm really glad to listen to stories of people who had so much fun with the game, because it just makes me realize that I did something decent in this life. So yeah, I mean, thanks for playing the game, and I hope you continue to play any future games that I decide to make. So
yeah, I just want to send the same to you. Thank you for all of your hard work and laying the foundation for the game that the rest of us all play so much. And I think probably everyone watching this, there's quite a few people watching this, I'm not sure if you're aware. But thank you very much.
Well, you're welcome, guys. I'm glad to be of service. So okay, and, so yeah, hopefully you guys have some chance to check out Rust, you know. I mean, we're doing a lot of great stuff, so you know, I'm just gonna put out a plug there.
We most certainly
absolutely
will.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for your time, my friend, and it was a pleasure For me, it was a definite pleasure because I beta tested Counter-Strike back in the day as well, so I've been playing for a very, very long time. And, you know, I personally want to thank you for that. And it's been, you know, a great 14, 15 years now that I've been playing this game. So thank you so much for that. And we definitely appreciate your time.
Well, that's awesome, man. It's always good to hear from people who played, like, way back when. You know, it's always... I always think...
When you were working on it?
Yeah, yeah, you know, it kind of surprises me because most of the people that I used to play with, they kind of grew up and they just, you know, they stopped playing games. So it's always kind of surprising to meet people who played, like, the original betas. So it's kind of
I'll never grow up.
Well, that's good.
I refuse.
Yeah, always a kid at heart. Yeah, that's always good. So, yeah. Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me. And
take care of yourself.
Yeah, you guys, and good luck with everything. Good luck with the launch of, because I think you guys were going on Twitch or something, yeah. And best of luck with everything, and thanks for having me on, guys.
We definitely appreciate it. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, bye-bye. No probs. Hey, see you guys.
All right, guys, just want to make a quick announcement. We are aware that we are getting botted. The stream is getting botted. So we are currently on the phone right now. The owner of RGN is on the phone right now with our partner Twitch to get that resolved. But in the meantime, stay tuned. We have Cal Reloaded coming back up. And I just want to give a quick plug-in to our sponsors, Edge Game Servers, as well as David Media.